That person who wants to make public comment, Mike Donahue, if you would just stand so we can see you, that's great. Thank you.
It's perfect because you're right here. I want to thank you for your presentation. I thought it was very insightful and very well presented in terms of giving the public an understanding. When you're talking about this trough at Site 8, your materials say that there are three particular brooks that are fed by springs, and you were questioned about Knights Brook, but I'd like to ask you about Pickering Brook. Isn't that closer to this trough that you're talking about?
Yes.
And isn't the direction that the, I mean, I'm trying to read this map, and I don't think the public can see it up there, but it's there, that the trough seems to be pointed somewhat to the northeast, which is the direction of flow of Pickering Brook, isn't it?
Yes.
And Pickering Brook joins into the ditch that flagstone that outlets at that cove, and isn't that cove the cove that had some of the highest shellfish results? Thank you. My neighbor.
I'll put his ears back too.
She already has. So when you say it's just that it's flowing through the groundwater that's in bedrock and then bubbling up to these springs, isn't it possible that there's some direct outlet out of that trough?
There is the
can you use the microphone?
There's a slide that explains it. So this area here, this is more of a perspective of Pickering Brook, where what I don't have on here is the trough, but you can have the trough. The trough could be, this could be the trough. This low point right here could be the trough. Okay, what's happening as you, and this is again a part of our conceptual model is that in the trough, at the downgrading end of the trough, and the Pickering Brook does a jog, it goes down and it does a jog left and it does a jog right. And right at that jog, the trough shallows. And so I think what's happening is that the material in the overburden, or the contamination in the overburden here is coming up. It's being forced up because of the trough ends, and the groundwater that's in the trough is discharging into the brook at that point. So the brook actually starts as a spring further up gradient, but where this bend is, I think there's an influx of groundwater that's coming from the trough. And the reason I say that is we collected pore water samples, which are presented in the report, and you see the concentration of pore water samples. And a pore water sample is just a sample of water within a stream bed. It's the sediment. You're taking water samples from the sediment base of a stream bed, and what you're trying to look for is you're trying to you're trying to seek discharging groundwater. It's a cheap way of putting it in a well, basically, is what it is. The concentrations were higher at this up here, which is closer to the source area, which is the fire training area, and they gradually decreased as you went down gradient until you got to that bend, and then they went up again. And it's like, wow, why did that happen? Well, I think because you've got this contaminated groundwater here that's discharging up into that stream. So I think you're right, and I think that is why we see this. And so right after we see that increase in concentrations, it starts declining again. The pore water samples concentration starts declining again as you go downstream. So to me, that says that there's no new sources coming in, and it's declining because of dilution, because you have cleaner groundwater from the overburden that's draining into Pickering Brook from the sides as you go down. So you get more mixing, and it continues to decline as you go down. But that spot right there, you do see a spike in the concentration. That being said, the extraction system, the pumping wells that we have in the trough, again, are going to stop that. The whole point of that is to prevent further offsite migration of PFAS compounds, and that will stop that. So the water that's going to be discharging at that bend it will eventually be clean water that's going to be discharging through the bend.
Thank you.
Does that answer your question?
Thank you. With that, let's come back to the RAB. This is time for open discussion. It's fine if you want to continue the conversation about the presentation. It's also fine if you want to talk about anything else. We have 20 minutes or a little bit more. Mindy. Oh, Andrea.
I was just wondering if you could, Roger, go into detail about what's going to happen tomorrow. There's like a meeting and what time that's going to take place.
So the original intention when we first briefed it was we thought the report would be further along, mm-hmm. because we weren't aware of the shellfish issue, and we were going to go through cover to cover. Mm-hmm. And the intention for tomorrow now has shifted. So there's actually been a lot of detailed questions tonight related to the geology and things, and we really wanted to bring all of those pieces together. You know, lay out the figures from the report, show sort of the distribution within this geology of what the SI found. Mm-hmm. But because obviously we're not to a point that the report and conclusions are anywhere close to being final, then we're holding that part of the discussion back. So it'll be a much deeper dive into each one of these topics and showing also where we found the chemical contamination as well. So not just the groundwater movement. This was sort of a primer to get how groundwater gets to where it is, and then tomorrow is going to be that overlay of what we found. So some of the data that was on the disk, so you'll get those two things brought together, basically.
Are you planning to have another meeting at some point to do what you said, cover to cover, for the ESI?
Yeah, I think we have to, and you know, okay. If it's something that we, you know, similarly, you know, if the December RAB works out to be it and we can schedule a date on either side, no, I think I don't want to spoil the end, but I think we're working on a Thursday, so doing it after the RAB is going to be extremely problematic, but, mm-hmm. you know, possibly the earlier in the week before.
Okay. Thank you. Will tomorrow be open to the public? Is that just RAB members?
The intention was for RAB members.
Okay. I was wondering what the status is of the iron issue at Site 8, and if that has been fixed, and if so, what is the current capacity of the filtering going on? I think before it's been down to like 30% because of that.
Yeah, it's hovering around 45. Rob, I don't know if you have a quick update. We did try to bring one more well into the mix. And so to answer the first part of your question, we issued a request for proposal to Wood to give us a bid for installing an iron removal system that will allow us to get to full capacity. Now, that's a lot of capital construction. So we don't have that contract modification finalized. And when it is, then we got some long lead items like the clarifier and things that we're going to use to remove the iron, take, you know, 3 or 4 months before they'll even be fabricated and show up on site. So the installation of that is probably going to be early 2020.
Okay.
So it's still a while before we're close to full capacity there.
And do you expect, I think you've answered this before, but you don't expect those same iron issues at Ames?
We're not seeing it. We've moved so much more water through Ames already that I think if we were going to find it, we would have found it.
And is Ames 100% operational, or do you have any challenges there?
No, I think, I mean, we're...
It's up and running. We, as of today, we're pumping 600 gallons a minute. We're still ramping up the irrigation well, which is lower next to Ames well. Mm-hmm. We're bringing that up to full speed because, you know, just flip it on, sure, and pump 30 gallons a minute. So, but we're at 600 gallons.
Can we repeat that for the microphone?
Yeah, so everybody can hear that. So when we did the ribbon cutting ceremony in July, and the well we call the interim mitigation well that's located very close to the Haven was not online at that time. It has since been brought online. We're operating at about 600 gallons a minute with a, you know, target of 650 to 700 for normal routine operations there. So that plan is just humming along. Everything's looking...
It's a lot of ground.
Yeah, and no challenges. You haven't run into
not at this time. I mean, we're noticing some things in plant design, you know, just basic things to make the operators' lives easier and things like that. But it's running exactly as expected.
Okay, all right, thanks.
What about the PFAS levels? Are you sampling that?
The sampling's happening today. I think they were out there doing the performance monitoring today. We're monitoring the influent. We're around 2 ppb, I think, for PFAS only. The rest of it, I'm not really sure off the top of my head. But
2 parts per billion?
Yes.
Going into the well?
Going into the combined influent. So, you know, that most of that data is going to be from the upper extraction system, so the one closer to the Ames building itself on the parking ramp.
Can I ask one more question as a follow-up?
Can,
yeah.
You, take
that
the, can you take the mic?
We're in the middle. Go ahead.
No. What's the source of the iron, do you think?
Just naturally occurring deposits. So, you know, the unfortunate thing, we did 3 test borings at site 8, and all of them came back with relatively low iron. So we installed the rest of the extraction wells, and then we flipped the plant on, just what was in the geology at that point. I don't think there's no man-made source of the iron. I think it's, you know, we were unlucky with the test borings, and, you know, now we're putting a remedy into to fix it and get back online.
Just the last thing I wanted to say was just more of an update. I know it's come up a lot about Newington having a lot of questions around blood testing and health issues, and so we were able to ask ATSDR to invite someone from Newington to be on the CAP, which addresses the health issues, and Karen Anderson from Newington was officially put on the Pease CAP, and she attended our first meeting, which was September 5th, I think. Couple weeks ago. So I just wanted to give that update because I know that has come up at a couple other meetings. Thank you.
So the quick question I had was for Peter. In our last meeting, the minutes say that you were evaluating. Do you have an update for us on the signage?
Excuse me, I said the date. I'm not sure.
It says evaluating community's request for signage about potentially contaminated game in the area.
And I'm not sure that's completely accurate. What I had said actually was that the DS and the sister agencies, New Hampshire Fish and Game, State Veterinarian, were all looking at the ability to do the testing. As part of that, signage would be is being evaluated. So I'm assuming at this point, I don't want to speak for Fish and Game, who would be the authority there, but I'm guessing that they are going to base whatever actions they have on this refuge hunt.
Do we have to make a formal written request or something? Because it's been 3 months, so plus,
yeah, so
6 months plus.
Based on tonight's
months.
Action items, I do have the 3 questions for Fish and Game, so I plan on.
Should we make a written request? Will that help push it along, or does it necessary? Or
It certainly can't hurt. Okay. My question to them would have been, or can be, you know, what is a written request required for that, or what would their plan be? So.
Thank you. Lula?
I just had, because we have the time, a couple of questions relative to the action items. And I was curious about action item 36 and its research into the definition of site in the RAB rules that shapes the bounds for the types of environmental remediation. Can the Superfund boundary be extended, or does it need to be? And the reply was something about the EPA and DOD generally follow this particular definition and summary. It limits the contamination for something on a national contingency plan. I don't have any idea what any of that means, but was the purpose of trying to extend the boundaries of this site to try to capture some of the things happening in Newington off the Pease?
Yeah, we're not restricted. I mean, so the site, when it's first listed, because you don't have a great understanding of where everything, where the releases were and how far it may have traveled or hasn't traveled. So over the 20 years of, you know, the 25, 30 years of investigation at the site, so we have a decent understanding. Now, I said that, I would confidently say that back in 2014. Now that all bets are off once we found this stuff. So, yeah, so now, right, so now this other contaminant, this other sort of emerging contaminant, which would be considered a contaminant and under CERCLA. So, yeah, so the investigation, so we would sort of consider contamination, this new contamination, and how, where that is or where it may wind up as part of site.
But Lulu, you, the way you just asked the question, I would like to respond, because I think this was a question from you.
I think it was from Jamie.
Was it Jamie about can we or should we expand it in order to somehow capture environmental impact?
Well, we're doing that. We're essentially doing that, and that's the point of the ESI. I mean, we're not stopping at the boundary. I think maybe there was a perception that somehow we stop at this artificial boundary, and certainly when we were doing Site 8 before the PFAS, it was well beyond the site boundary. So it sort of follows that same logic. This stuff now requires us to look further.
So that's good news. But where are we? One of the action items said that the letter from the Air Force said that once we finish this ESI, the extended site investigation, and it is expected that there will be feedback that says there has been actionable release of these contaminants into the environment, it needs to be cleaned up. That triggers CERCLA. And does that, that triggers some event and budgetary, I don't know what it was, the ability to ask for funds.
I mean, it's probably a longer, complicated answer than I have time to give. So there's something called the Federal Facilities Agreement that was signed when Pease was put on the Superfund list. So when it was listed on the National Priorities list, that lay out the federal and state responsibilities. And that agreement triggers with the remedial investigation. So there's a presumption that the site investigation, the SI phase, has already been done. So that doesn't, you know, we went all the way through the entire CERCLA process on a lot of sites. And you know, this one sort of stepped us out a little bit, but where that federal facilities agreement, where those enforceable schedules, where those federal and state obligations kick back in is when we're doing the remedial investigation. And that's really what the letter is summarizing. So, you know, there's not a good basis or ground rules for how we conduct ourselves. And generally speaking, we follow the agreement no matter what. But those rules aren't explicitly written for how to do a site inspection 30 years after you started the CERCLA process.
So in that case, when we get to that point where we're in the RI, the remedial investigation, and there are things that could happen to improve the environment in Newington, like this whole Knightsbrook area or Pickering Brook, where we've got the contaminated groundwater coming up to the surface and literally spreading out into the fields rather than making a straight shot into the bay where it can be diluted. At what point can those things be discussed? I know I tend to bring them up too early at RAB meetings, but at what point can we think of discussing those?
So, I mean, those would fall into something that we call removal actions. So it's different than a, you know, a full-on remedial process. So you don't go through a full-blown study. So if there's indication during the remedial investigation that there's an unacceptable risk to human health or the environment, so that's some of the study that, you know, that you guys are asking for. So, you know, as any time during the remedial investigation, if that determination is clear, we can do a removal action, which is a very accelerated process to do something about it. So we don't have to necessarily wait to the end if we encounter a situation like that requires some short-term action.
So the reason that's so important in the town of Newington is the springs that are feeding these brooks. Originally, the brooks are maybe 3 feet wide. But as it goes out into the fields and the forest and with the wetlands ordinances as they are now, what used to be like 110 acres of wetlands is now 410 acres of wetlands. So all of this PFAS is pooling out as it's not just in the brook stream, it's pooling out over the land. Now, I know all of the stuff going on in Site 8 is exciting, but for the next 20 years, 30 years that we're living in Newington, it would be good to know that something could be done to ditch the brooks or to keep the continued contaminating water that's coming up underground only in a narrow stream, prevent it from flowing into the fields around it. Just as, I don't know if you call it remedial or what, I mean, where in the process would you call something like that?
Well, we'd have to have a reason to do it. And the data that we've collected, at least thus far in the surface water, I don't know that they're, you know, from the couple exposure pathways that were evaluated in the expanded SI, right now there hasn't been anything triggering us to take that action because there hasn't been a defined risk.
So let's go back a minute again on the schedule. Because defined risk is, yeah, I can't drink the water, I can wade in it, I can swim in it as long as I don't drink it. But on the other hand, I don't want the cows drinking it or, you know, the hens or anything else drinking it. How long would it take to do those studies? Because if we can't even get them started where you're testing hay or testing agricultural products, I mean, we're never going to get to the remediation phase.
So I did take an action item to line out the RI scoping and the schedule and the sort of that time frame. So I will do that. But
so Mike, from the EPA standard, I know what Roger's saying. He's saying we've got to do these studies just like with shellfish or with anything else, drinking water. We've got to say that there's a threshold. If you're below the threshold, tough luck, you're not getting any treatment. But in the meantime, if you have a water system that is known to be contaminated at high levels, it would seem to me that it's not appropriate to continue to let that system expand, because it will continue to expand. There's already a huge marsh around most of these brooks. And if you don't do anything with the trees falling down or the beavers or whatever get in there, you don't have a managed wetland. You end up with a mess. So is there anything in the regulations that can address the prevention of expansion of the contamination?
Yeah, and I think that's where the Site 8 remedy, I think it's sort of important to that aspect to, I think, the contamination in Newington is it's supposed to try to cut that off. I mean, that was the presentation. It's not just groundwater, but it's that connection to the springs as well. You know, and again, it gets back to the scoping, and you look at what we have, where we can, again, risk is, I don't want Mindy, how she, when you talked about risk, because I know we're just dealing with three PFAS, and I know that's sort of what we're restricted to, unfortunately. You know, things are coming. We hope to get new additional toxicity information, so then we can start to, because I think risk, is a loaded word, I think, when we talk about risk, because I think that's the problem. I think we all understand and realize it's an emerging contaminant, and we're sort of making up as we go. You know, that's how I feel sometimes. We're well ahead of the curve of
not emerging.
Yeah, I guess we're not. Yeah. Not. But well, it is in the sense that it would not be so emerging to me if we had more toxicity information. And I would feel, and I'm waiting. I'm dying for more toxicity information to come so we can start. Again, starting to look, when we talk about risk, we can start to address some of your legitimate concerns relative to these other contaminants. I don't disagree with you on that, I truly don't. But it's my frustration, is your frustration. But so getting back to where we are today, I mean, we have to look at risk in the context, unfortunately, of these three PFAS that we have, levels that we are accepted, currently accepted, and then we go through the process. So.
I understand.
Lou, I also want to give Mindy a chance in the next couple moments. So if you want a final response, I think that's fine. And then
relating to that, it's like we've defined risk in a number of ways, depending upon whether we're talking about drinking water, wading, swimming, whatever.
Eating shellfish.
But we haven't defined risk in a way that is going to impact the residential area in the town of Newington, where that whole center of the town is now swamped with these chemicals. Now, I know how we've defined it so far says you've just got to live with it, tough luck. At some point, Site 8 remediation is going to work, and down the line, it's going to clean up. What I'm trying to ask is, it would seem to me that in the EPA or the Clean Water Guidelines, that once you know a problem exists, to allow that to continue to spread further into the environment in the residential part of Newington shouldn't happen. So is that...
I can only speak for the jurisdiction, which is the Superfund, which is what I work on. You know, there is no clean water, there is no surface water standards for this stuff. I mean, we under CERCLA, we're using toxicity values that we are trying to sort of screen for where we have potential completed pathways and what the potential risks for those are. But, you know, again, as you mentioned, clean water, there's no, we don't have, the only, if you would ask somebody what's the surface water standard, there is none. There's no surface water standards.
I thought in New Hampshire the surface water standard was the drinking water standard.
No? MCL was the AGQS, so the groundwater cleanup standard. The AGQS, ambient groundwater quality standard, is the same as the maximum contaminant level for drinking water. We do have surface water standards established for many compounds, but not for PFAS. At this point, the only values we have are the screening levels that EPA issued for those three, PFOS, PFOA, PFBS. Our environmental health program is evaluating those surface water screening levels, the shellfish screening levels, looking at establishing deer meat screening levels. So
I want to acknowledge the incredible frustration of knowing some things there, right, that you were all tracking and working on. Many of the people in this room are working on this full time, right, to really try to get a handle on it in different ways. And it's incredibly frustrating that it's new, that it's complicated. Like, we all looked at how the water moves, and the regulations and the responsibilities are confusing. But I think what you're doing, all of you here sitting at this table, is trying to surface the community, concerns, questions, things you want to advocate for, which I think I just want to acknowledge you're doing very well of giving voice to these things. And the three individuals who a lot of those are getting sort of sent toward may not have the answers at this time, and they're doing their best also to share what they know, and we're all learning together. That may or may not be helpful, but that's sort of what's going on in my head as I sit with you. I want to move to Mindy and give her a last chance, and we're going to keep having all these sort of, there are like eight threads of conversation about this that we are going to keep having.
Well, this kind of supports what Lulu's talking about, because we've been looking closely at the shellfish and sediment data, and in the control areas where there are no PFAS or very low PFAS detected in the sediment samples, there's none in the shellfish either. So, and vice versa, where there are very high levels in the sediment, there are also high levels in the shellfish. So we're concerned about that connection. And so that kind of piggybacks on what Lulu's saying. And you know, this really does have an impact on the things that we eat, the things that we, and you know, I'm concerned about what is in the bay, actually, too. And the active shellfishing that goes on there. People, I went to the bay the other day, and a woman said, I clam here all the time, all of this. You know, so that's a concern, and people are eating that food, and they have no idea what they're eating, and we don't know. And in fact, you know, if you were in Michigan, they probably would tell you not to eat that shellfish or fish that's in those brooks. So they have a 12 part per trillion limit in surface water. If it's in surface water, you shouldn't eat the fish, and it's different fish, but in Michigan, that's what the state of Michigan does.
That's actually inaccurate. So the levels that were defined and the levels that Michigan used for deer were derived from their fish tissue levels, and there's a gradation of how much fish you can eat. And their unrestricted level is very, very similar to our 0.1.
I'm going to check that because I believe.
Yeah, I have the document. Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, Michigan DHHS. So the fish consumption advisory value is for PFAS, and they only have them for PFAS.
Right.
But the 12 part per trillion is a surface water
Correct.
Screening indicator, but it does not have anything to do with the tissue itself.
I'll check into that.
Okay, that's fine.
But, if you can share that.
I can bring it up tomorrow.
Either way, it's still a concern, and especially with some of the non-target PFAS, the PFPEA in particular, that's the PFOA replacement. That was the subject of the big media blitz with the FDA chocolate cake thing. These are 3 to 4 times the levels in those cake samples that are in the oyster samples that are in those brooks, especially Flagstone Brook. So that is a huge concern of mine. So that's why I keep asking about So I would really like to know the answer to those questions as soon as possible about the signage. In fact, before the next meeting, if we could get the answer. My other question is, now that the new MCLs are going into effect in New Hampshire, are there people in Newington that are drinking water from private wells that exceed those numbers, the new MCLs?
So, yeah, we scrubbed that data, and the answer is yes. There are.
Okay. So the state doesn't have a groundwater monitoring program for Newington, or do we? Okay, so what's going to happen on October 1st with those private wells? What's the state going to do?
Pending the determination of the applicability of those standards to DOD, then.
But
then
either way, the state is going to have to do something about it, right?
I can't speak on their behalf. But, you know, so I don't want to hypothesize because I don't want to get myself in a position of guessing what DOD is going to tell us. So, but we are.
Will you let us know on October 1st what the answer is?
Yes, as soon as I know the answer, because I understand the importance of that. And, you know, we have put the gears in motion to do the same initial response that we did for homes that were discovered to be above the previous health advisory. So
what gap?
Initially bottled water. So you know, the GAG systems take time to procure and install and things like that. But, you know, I can't say yes, absolutely, we're going to provide it.
Can you tell me how many wells that is?
We're looking at five.
Thank you for pinpointing that, Mindy. That's helpful. All right, we're going to shift to wrapping up and next steps. I have a whole bunch of them. I moved seats so many times, I just have them on my paper, but I'm going to read them to all of you so you can tell me if I missed any, which I may well have. But here's what I've got. We're going to keep tracking our action items list. Our next meeting will be on December 5th, which is a Thursday, because it worked best for the group. It's different from normal, but it was the one that worked best for the most people, December 5th. I will send that out to the whole list and our sort of interested parties list.
Back at DES.
Back at DES, thank you. Air Force is going to send their new shellfish data summary table and results when they have that. The Air Force is going to find a way to share the five-year review before the RAB so people can read it and take a look at it in advance, and send an update on the Department of Defense review of the MCLs and AMBI that we were just talking about, that piece. There's a request to figure out, are there ways to determine what was in the firefighting foam? There is a request to, and I guess that's linked to a request to find out if the Department of Defense has ever asked what was in the foam. That's all kind of the same thing. Peggy and Brian are gonna talk about Newington and Wells more. The Air Force is gonna provide timeline, then stages on the RI, and sort of the phasing and all of that. Peter is gonna ask New Hampshire Fish and Game if they would come give some presentations on these different questions, mm-hmm. not just email responses. The Air Force is gonna schedule another extended site investigation meeting for RAB members once there's a completed draft so that they can share conclusions. Roger's gonna share the Michigan advisory consumption numbers with Mindy and or with the whole RAB.
Do you need to take that as a formal action item or do you just want to see it tomorrow? I know it's on my computer.
Sorry, it's other people, do you want to see it
too? The Michigan advisory numbers? Can you send it to the group? Or?
Yeah, that's
great.
So leave it on there.
And Mindy has requested a response on signage in particular as soon as possible. That's what I've got for action items. Let me know if you don't see yours when I type it up, or if you didn't hear it now, if you remember. any other final thoughts? I think our agenda for the December 5th meeting will include the five-year review results, a description of the remedial investigation scoping process in detail, possibly something on the new shellfish data conclusions, even if that's quick.
That's a whole meeting.
That's a whole meeting. That's not quick. Meeting. Sorry, I inserted that. I'm going to remove it.
I mean, between the three. That's all.
Oh, the three meetings. Oh, yeah.
The agenda is pretty well set.
So out of curiosity, when you listen to the news and hear that Trump wants to have an executive decision relative to the Clean Water Act, does that impact any of them?
I would think it would.
I
don't know the context of the statement, though.
I'll send you the email. Did you see it, Mike, about something with the Clean Water Act?
Don't.
I think we can't put our agency people on the spot. Yeah. Any other?
A little bit. We'll talk.
Any other final thoughts from anybody before we wrap up? All right. Thank you all very much. Have a really nice fall, and we'll see you after Thanksgiving.